Hi, and welcome to the summer edition of Museum Roadshow. I'm Mike Anderson, the Public Relations and Marketing Director at the Reading Public Museum. We've got a couple of location segments to look at on today's program, and we'll get to them in just a few moments, but first I'd like to remind you of a couple of the events and exhibitions and the happenings here at the Reading Public Museum in the next few weeks. In our Science Gallery, continuing through September 7th, you'll see Electricity. It's a classic set of 16 hands-on interactive displays which engage you in the exploration of fundamental properties of electricity. It's a real classic, and you'll have fun pressing all the buttons there and seeing what happens. Like we said, it's interactive. Also, check out a couple of the exhibits that opened recently. First is City Blocks in our Central Gallery, and it's on through August 30th. It's an interactive, again, exhibition featuring themed stations where you can build your own architectural creations from over 10,000 city blocks, wooden construction blocks. You see some models there of falling water, the Frank Lloyd Wright house out in western PA. There's the museum built entirely of city blocks that can be put together without glue, and we have those models there. But in addition, it's fun and it gives kids of all ages a chance to explore the concepts of architecture and to experience the pleasure of discovery and accomplishment. There, like we said, there's 10,000 city blocks there and various workstations and some challenges to build roller coasters, bridges, castles, all kinds of things. So that's a lot of fun. That's going on, again, now through August 30th. We also have an exhibition that's themed and called Frank Lloyd Wright, Architecture of the Interior and the Art of Seating. It's on display through July 27th. The architecture of the interior portion in and around our Works on Paper gallery downstairs in the ground floor includes 19 high-quality reproduction drawings, 8 photographs, photographic murals, and offers it offers a chance for you to see some of Frank Lloyd Wright's finest interior collections and how he thinks conceptually from not only where the houses go, but what goes inside it from top to bottom. As a partner to that, part of the Art of Seating thing, you'll get a chance to see some of the, chairs from the early 19th century all through to the present day. You get to see, for example, there's a Frank Lloyd Wright chair. You get to see from all different, there's a chair that you'll see featured from the very popular TV series Pawn Stars on the History Channel. It was featured and used by Senator Patrick McCarran, featured on the one of the episodes, and we'll see more on that one a little later in the program. So that's up in our second floor galleries. You'll see a lot more about that, and also it's tied in with the Frank Lloyd Wright whole theme of architecture, like we did with the City Blocks thing as well. There's also a wonderful show going on now through September 1st in our American Gallery. It's entitled Masterpieces of American Long Rifles. And right now, here's Scott Sweigert, our curator of art and civilization, to tell you more and give you a brief tour of the exhibition itself.
Thanks, Mike. Welcome, everyone, to the Masterpieces of American Long Rifles, the Kindig Family Collection here in the American Gallery on the museum's second floor. It's a world-class collection of American long rifles that comes to us from the Kindig Family Vault, which is known as the premier collection of this sort of antique firearm in the world. So the museum is thrilled to have it here. I'm standing in front of a section that's dedicated to Joe Kindig Jr., who is the beginning, the founding father of the Kindig antique dynasty. He was born in the late 19th century, and by the time he was in high school, he was dealing in antique firearms, put himself through college at Penn State, and decided to put the family business of horses aside in favor of the antique business. He dealt in European high art arms and armor, such as this Maximilian suit of armor right behind me, the wonderful Philadelphia desk and bookcase as well. So it was not just the firearms, it also included all aspects of antiques. The family placed over the years many, many pieces in the most prominent museums throughout the nation, including the Metropolitan, Winterthur in Delaware, the Philadelphia Museum of Art, and many others. The firearms became an interest to Joe Kindig as a history lesson, as the development of 18th century firearms in the nation. And it was something that he loved the most. It was definitely his passion. And he assembled this collection, which now numbers right around 500 or so. Many of them are still in the family. Again, we've got about 70 of them here in the exhibition, along with a selection of decorative arts. Things like the World of the Gunsmith, which features Pennsylvania German elements, fracture, painted furniture, elements from Lancaster County. And then we also have a section of the show that compares the high style that was popular in urban areas such as Philadelphia versus the rural styles, which were popular in other portions of southeastern Pennsylvania. So the show places the guns, as was Joe Kindig's philosophy, in the context of other American decorative arts. He thought that there was as much artistry in them as there was the finest pieces produced by the best cabinet makers in Philadelphia. The unique qualities of these firearms was really what got Joe excited, and that continues through today. The family business is still around, run by Jen Kindig, their granddaughter, of Joe Kindig Jr. and Joe the Third as well. So again, we're thrilled to have this exhibition here at the Reading Public Museum. It's on view through September 1st of this year. So please visit, enjoy the guns, and tell your friends to come in. In addition to the rifles and the loans from the Kindig family collection, we've integrated some decorative arts from the museum's collection, including the famous black unicorn dower chest from the late 18th century. We tried to assemble a group of American decorative arts from the late 18th and early 19th century to give the context of the world that the gunsmith would have been working in. At the time, Berks County, Lancaster County, Franklin and Adams, and York were sort of the wilds. They were really on the fringe. They were the frontier. And the gunsmiths there lived pretty in simple surroundings, humble surroundings, with the traditions passed down from generation to generation. An example like this, the painted dower chest, would have been given to a young individual, both men and women, who were on their way to starting lives on their own. It would have contained possessions and objects that were important to them, precious things that they would have wanted to store. We've also got examples of Pennsylvania fracture, this writing style which was popular in the 18th and early 19th century as well. Most of these documents were birth certificates. Some of them were marriage certificates, baptismal certificates as well. So in this section, we try to sort of recreate the context of that 18th century gunsmith's world.
Thanks, Scott. As Scott said, this particular show is on through September 1st, so don't miss it. I'd like to kind of go back to our Frank Lloyd Wright, The Art of Seating portion again, and mention that the chairs experienced in that exhibit are experienced not only as a functional item, but sculptural in view. So it represents the chair as art, and each of more than 50 chairs from all around the world were chosen for both their beauty and their historical context. Highlights include chairs like Frank Lloyd, designed by Frank Lloyd Wright, like you saw earlier, John Henry Belter, the Stickley brothers, Charles and Ray Eames, and Frank Gehry, among others. And also exclusive to this exhibition, the Art of Seating part of it, is a selection of several chairs from the Falling Water collection. You saw it earlier, a little model of Falling Water done in city blocks, but these are chairs actually from the home. And also, you'll see a famous pair of chairs used in the 1963 Walter Cronkite President Kennedy televised interview, and like we mentioned before, the floor chair from Patrick McCarran. So we're going to come back a little later after this break and see more about that chair itself and an interesting character to talk about it. We'll be right back.
You're watching bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other stories and information, go to bctv.org.
Welcome back. Recently, we had the chance to talk to the go-to history expert from the History Channel's popular show Pawn Stars, Mark Hall Patton, while he was here for the opening of the Frank Lloyd Wright exhibition. So let's watch. Mark, it's good to have you here in Reading. Welcome.
Well, thank you. Glad to be here.
You have any impressions of Berks County since you've been here?
You're very green.
Very green?
Yes, I'm
That's
not
right.
used
You're
to green.
Las Vegas.
Yes, it's, I'm used to a lot more beige, a lot more browns, reds, that sort of thing.
Right, but you look like you might be from around here. Is that an authentic Amish?
No, this one isn't, but my black hats, when you see them on the show, those are from Lancaster County here.
No kidding.
Yep.
No kidding. So you've been in this area before?
I did my graduate work out here at the University of Delaware.
Great.
Oh, yeah.
But now you're the administrator of the Clark County, Nevada
Museum system.
System. But we all know you as the go-to expert, history expert on Pawn Stars. What's that like? I mean, now you're a celebrity. I mean, when does a museum administrator become a celebrity? How?
How, I'm not really quite sure. I just got a call out of the blue when the show started up, actually when they were doing the pilot episodes, and asked me whether I could go on and look at a West Point uniform coat and tell them whether it was real. And I said, sure, I can do that. And they said, can you tell us what it's worth? I said, no. And they said, well, you know, here's our idea for this show that we're going to do. And I said, well, it's a fine idea for a show, but museums, that's not what we do.
Right.
They said, well, we'll try anyways, and they're still trying me anyways, so it seems to work out for
them.
They
ask you that. Well, you seem to know everything about everything, so, I mean, it's incredible. You just happen to, let me get a buddy of mine down here to check it out, and you walk in, and you know the complete history on it. Is that on the spot, or do you have
No. I do research on everything, but the one thing I will say is I do all my own research. So if I come in and I say something, I will stand behind what I'm saying. You know, it isn't something where, you know, I've got a team of researchers or the show has a team of researchers. No, if they call me, and it's the same way with the other experts. If they call them in, they're coming in and they're saying what they know about that item.
Okay. So you get a little bit of time to check it out ahead of time, but the reveal is spontaneous?
Oh, yeah. They have no idea what we're saying. They have no idea what I'm going to say.
Good.
Half the time, they don't even know whether I'm going to say it's real or not when I get there.
So half the time, is it real? Or
I figure about 70% of the time, it's sort of close to what they think it is.
I see.
And another 30% of the time, it's completely fake. But even the ones where it's semi-close, there's probably 20 to 30% of that it's close, but it's not quite what they think it is.
Any delightful surprises as far as what people think it is, and maybe it's something better or completely different, but just as valuable.
Yeah, the one that's in this show, the Senator McCarran chair, was one that I came in thinking it was not real, thinking it could not be real, because the only way you can own a senatorial chair is if you buy it when you go out of office. Now, Senator McCarran died in office. So if he bought it, I don't want to be at that sale. But when I talked to the fellow who brought it in, who didn't know anything about Senator McCarran, all he knew was that his company employees had given him this chair as a retirement gift. And they had bought it at an estate sale in Washington. So he didn't know anything about it. It's just a senatorial chair. Well, I'm looking at it and said, okay, do you know whose estate it was? He said, yes, it was a lady named Eva Adams. And I said, yes, that's what I needed to know. Because Eva Adams was a high school librarian in Las Vegas that Patrick McCarran chose to run his senatorial office. She was quite organized in that. So he brought her back to Washington. She became so well known there that she trained other senatorial office staffs. She worked for the next three senators from Nevada.
Okay.
And she got to Allen Bible. And Allen Bible didn't get along with her, but she was too well known. So he couldn't get rid of her. So he went to the president, who happened to be John F. Kennedy at the time, and said, "Can you find another job for her?" And Kennedy said, "Sure, I'll make her the director of the U.S. Mint."
Okay.
And she's
so
the one.
That's why the name is.
Yeah,
is
she became very prominent there. She upgraded the mint, got rid of silver in our coinage, all kinds of different things, brought in the clad coinage that we have today, all of that. So she was about the only person who would have had the ties to be able to get this chair,
right,
and would have had the emotional ties to have wanted it.
Yeah.
You know, so it was wonderful to get that to fit. You know, there are ones that I've looked at, John Wesley Hardin's business card, for example, that I looked at and I said, I can't tell you for sure. It was, you know, I was about 80% certain,
right,
that it was in fact real.
Mm-hmm.
So after we filmed, I went back and did more research and found out that, yes, it was in fact correct.
Okay, so that if it wasn't, you could stop production of the show.
Well, no. If I make a mistake, I'll stand, you know, I'll admit.
Okay.
I mean, I can have feet of clay. I'm just a human.
Okay.
You know, and I have made one error,
yeah,
in 130 appearances that I know of.
That's a good batting average.
Yeah, and I can tell you about it. If you ever have this opportunity and somebody offers you a Soviet ICBM launch key. Now, there's only five pairs in the United States.
I think I remember that one.
Yeah, but if somebody offers you one and you look at it and you think, well, is this a rocket launch key or an ICBM launch key? And I said it was a rocket launch key. I was wrong on that. You know, the difference between the two is if you lay it down on the table, the prong on the rocket launch key goes straight up, and the prong on the Soviet ICBM launch key goes off to the side.
Everybody knows that, right?
Well, now they do.
Now they do.
So I can make an error once
acceptable.
In a while.
That's acceptable. Now, in the case of the chair, the McCarran chair, you being located centrally in Nevada, and you probably have a lot more Nevada history up in your head than most people do. So first time you saw the chair, you kind of knew you had a head start on some of that information, right? Or did you really have to start from scratch on research on the McCarran?
Well, what I knew, I knew who McCarran was.
Right. There's an airport named after him.
Well, I've got a museum in that airport.
Yeah,
so,
right. Okay.
Yeah, so I've done research on him. I've written about him,
okay,
and that. So I knew who he was.
Yeah.
The trick on this was, can you get the chair?
Right.
So I talked to the U.S. Senate, talked to the Senate historian about the history of the chairs, went out and did research on their design, research on how they were manufactured, and then talked to the Senate about, can you own one of these chairs? And looked up, you know, what is that process?
Yeah.
Because some of the things that you have come in, you know, we've had pieces come in that I've looked at and said, I don't know whether you can own that.
I noticed that on the show, a lot of with firearms, that's the big issue.
Oh, yeah.
Or any,
mm-hmm,
any kind of firearms.
Yeah.
Is it legal? Is one of the first questions Rick asks. You know,
right. And in his case, he doesn't have an FFL. So he can't buy anything after 1898.
Right.
Okay. And that's understandable. That was a decision he made. At one point in the history of the shop, they did have an FFL, and they dealt in all kinds of firearms, but
yeah,
they decided it was too much trouble, and they got rid of it. And so now they only deal in the antique firearms,
right,
which is fine. But we had a piece come in that was a counterfeit $10 bill,
mm-hmm,
that had been signed by the FBI agents that had confiscated it and was given to the Attorney General of the United States in 1948 or 49.
Yeah.
And the guy who brought it in.
So when it's out of circulation, it has to be out of circulation.
Well, no, the problem was we didn't know this was coming in until we filmed.
Uh-huh.
We knew that the credentials for this Attorney General were coming in.
Okay.
And this guy pulled out the credentials and he pulled out this counterfeit $10 bill. And I looked at that and I said, I don't think so. And I made a phone call just to be sure that I was right on the law. And you can't own counterfeit currency.
Wow.
So we told him on the show, take this right outside, right, take it down to the U.S. Treasury Department, turn it in, because you can't have it. And that sort of thing will happen. People don't know. And
well,
he bought it in a garage sale.
That's the great thing about the show. You learn,
yeah,
things like that. And it's fascinating on all levels, from the comedy of Chumley to the, you know, to the fact that the variety of things that come through the door. Now, because of your stardom, you're out doing a lot of personal appearances, right?
Oh, yeah, I do some.
And what was your connection here? How did you get involved with doing the Reading Public Museum?
Well, actually, John, your director, contacted me about the chair. He had seen the episode, and you were doing this wonderful chair exhibit.
Right.
And so he contacted me. I talked to the shop, because it's still owned by the Gold and Silver Pawn Shop. It was on loan to my museum.
Okay.
And they were amenable to loaning it. Good. And then as we talked about it, he asked me whether I would come back, and I like this area. I spent some time back here when I was in graduate school, and I needed some more hats. So,
you need some more hats.
You know,
you did purchase some on your trip.
Yes, I bought two this morning.
Good.
Yes, oh yes. But it was, and so, you know, we've had a chance to get back here, and I like supporting museums. I've been in this field for 37 years now.
Right.
It's what I do for a living.
Is that what you considered your main gig now,
or are you a full-time
celebrity?
I'm just a museum administrator.
Okay. Well, you know, not just that. You've elevated that position. There was a time when nobody would have noticed or recognized the museum administrator in the crowd, and now you get recognized all the time.
Well, yes, and unfortunately now I'm just a museum administrator that's recognized in 151 countries in the world.
Wow.
So, yes, and translated into 34 languages.
Is it translated, or did they dub other languages?
No, they dub other ones.
Oh, really?
In.
Yeah. That must be fun to see.
I sound very good in Turkish, I'm told.
can you say anything in Turkish?
Not a thing.
Okay.
And I sound good in Italian. But I'm supposed to sue the guy in southern Mexico who does me in Spanish. In northern Mexico, I'm okay, but the guy in southern Mexico doesn't sound like me.
Oh, okay, it's completely different.
Yes, I don't know, but you know, it's a very strange thing when somebody says, you ought to sue that guy. Okay, thank you. I don't know who that is.
Well, we're certainly glad to have you here. Do you want to talk a little bit about the chair specifically before we say adios, as we say
sure,
in Mexico?
Sure, do you want to take a look at it?
Sure.
It's right over here behind us.
You're right.
Mark, this is the famous chair. Tell us a little bit about it.
Well, the interesting thing about it is it's a very plain design. The design goes back to the early 19th century, and it is very specific to the U.S. Senate. These were designed for the Senate chamber. And in the Senate chamber, you cannot take the desks out of the chamber. Those must stay in the chamber. In fact, certain desks can only be sat at by certain senators. It's like the senior senator from, I don't know, Virginia or somewhere gets Jefferson Davis's old desk, you know, that sort of thing. And everybody, when you are in the Senate, you take the drawer out of your desk and you sign the bottom of it to prove, okay, that was the one that I sat at. But the chairs, they have new ones made, but they're made on the same designs. And this is one of those, the design, as you can tell, is it's a neoclassical design from the early 19th century. You could tell if you saw the episode, it still squeaks when you move it around on its little casters. And all of that, when I was looking at it, was correct. And it has the name tag back here for Senator McCarran.
Right.
Because this was his chair, and everybody gets their own little name tag. Mm. But had it not come through in the direction that I said, through Eve Adams's estate, there wouldn't have been any way to say with absolute clarity, yes, this was his chair.
Have people tried to copy this type of thing? Does that come up occasionally?
Oh, yes.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, people, basically, you can figure if you can make a buck on it, somebody will try to copy it.
Yeah. Well, for those of you who want to see more about this chair and more about Mark's appearance on Pawn Stars, if you come to our exhibit, we have a video of that running continuously. We hope you come to see all of the other chairs that are here. And thank you, Mark, for being a part of this exhibition and for visiting us here at the Reading Public Museum.
Well, thank you. We're enjoying ourselves. My wife and I are enjoying ourselves here. It's a beautiful area.
Great. Thanks a lot.
Great guy, very knowledgeable and a lot of fun, and you'll learn a lot at our exhibition. Again, Frank Lloyd Wright, Architecture of the Interior and the Art of Seating, on through July 27th. So I hope you've learned a little bit more about our museum, your museum as it were, and that you visit us real soon. You'll find out everything you need to know and more at our website, readingpublicmuseum.org, including our upcoming Red, White, and Blues party on Friday, July 4th, Independence Day, and it features Lehigh Valley Blues Group. They're very popular, the James Supra Band, and it's a free concert. There they are now. It's a free concert in our Stone Terrace tent out in front of the museum, as part of our 52nd annual museum concert series, again on Friday, July 4th. Check it out. You can get a great parking space at the museum, enjoy food and drinks, and a high-energy show. Later, you can enjoy the fireworks across the street at the West Reading Playground. The doors to the tent open for our event at 6 p.m., and the music starts at 7 p.m., so food and beverages will be available there, provided by Viva Bistro and Tapas Lounge, and be available for purchase. The museum will not be open that day, but you can enjoy our beautiful arboretum. So thanks for watching. We hope you are back with us next time on Museum Roadshow, and we hope you come out and visit us at 500 Museum Road. Thanks for watching.